I'm sure we're going to have a very fun, interesting discussion. We're just in the back room while you guys were getting ready, and we just could not shut up. So let's get started with something simple and very personal. Let me get started with you, Stella, because you were telling us how you just fell into real estate. Tell us how that happened.
Yes, well, I just want to thank, firstly, could all the men put their hand up, please, who are in the room? That's good, we're getting there, that's four, that's excellent, thank you. This is about you, which will not be as good as we're going to say. Round of applause, thank you very much, men. How did I fall into real estate? I was actually in the hospitality industry. I was extremely outgoing, friendly, I enjoyed people, but I had no idea what real estate was about. I grew up in Hong Kong. My father was an expatriate, so I always had a house to live in. I didn't know what one did. I went to see a recruiter, and she was a good salesperson. She had a brother who was in real estate, and she knew that if I get this lady into real estate, she'll love it. And I did. I literally started Notting Hill at the very bottom, selling the dumps, not the nice places, the dumps in Notting Hill, and went from there.
Now, Christina, I know that you are a family-owned business, but did you know you were going to be doing this?
No, not at all. So I started out in investment bank, as Sherry mentioned earlier, and I did have a fantastic career, actually. So even though it's not in real estate, it's in finance, so equally, I think the women issue always come up. So I have had 16 years of actually a very smooth career. Obviously, there are different ways of dealing with all the corporate politics, or how we survive through the glass ceiling or whatnot. So I, you know, by the time I left the industry, I was an MD. So I was approached by my two older brothers, who was the co-founder of Core Capital, 2 years into business working, and who wanted to invite me to join partnership to actually lead the company to become an institutional one, because their background was actually more investing on behalf of the family business prior to founding Core Capital. And so while they have the good vibes with real estate deals, but they don't necessarily have the skill set to kind of get the company into an institutional mode to eventually get big institutional money, which obviously with my corporate background for 16 years, that was a skill set that naturally was very natural in me. But of course, that goes into like first 2 years of a lot of dynamics as to how you get the older brothers to kind of do what I think is right, you know, because in their mind they appreciate my professional background. That's why they invited me to join a partnership, actually at the height of the investment business, right before the drop, because I left kind of first quarter of 08, so that was still before the collapse. But anyway, so that I think in some questions I probably will touch on, so I probably will keep it short here.
Yes, we want to get into your family business and what that adventure has looked like. She's been telling us about that before. So Abel, also you've been here 20 years almost in Hong Kong doing real estate. Did you work somewhere else before Swire Properties?
Yes, I worked for another local small developer before I joined Swire Properties. But even I have to think about how I get into the real estate industry. It has to go back, well, scary, 30 years ago. It's a time where I have to think of what to study in university. And for me, it's a mix of factors. It's partly a rational process of elimination. When I cross out what I didn't want to study, like medicine, lawyers, or chemistry, quantity surveying came to the top choice. But I have to say there are a bit of emotional elements in it. My father was an interior decorator, so it's a related industry. And my boyfriend at that time was studying architecture. And by now, most of you will know how this two very important men has influenced my choice.
What was the most challenging part of that, of the transition?
Challenging? In terms of my work, I guess it's not hard to pick a time where when my son started to get into the primary school and I started to struggle in balancing the time between work and also family life, especially in tutoring, and in simple term being a tutor loan.
And you're not the only one who's struggling with that. You have two kids, you have Christina, you have four kids. How has that been working out?
that question always comes up, and I think I have to say that being in Asia is already a luxury. That of course there is no shortage of help, and I think my assistant also has help her at home. So I think generally it's acceptable. I love children, so I always know that I want to have kids. I just didn't know I would have four. and I was still actually was an investment bank when I had all four of them. So I wonder what, well, first of all, at Goldman Sachs, the first 6 years I was single, so I was working day and night. So I think that kind of proved myself that, you know, I'm not working and as capable, and then I got married and had two kids right away. So that was fine, because so I was 9 years at Goldman Sachs, and then UBS, I still vividly remember how that hiring manager hired me, was telling me, oh, you're gonna have a better lifestyle. Come into UBS, we're like very focused on diversity, you know, very focused on women, you know, needs and all that. So I went, and then actually at the beginning it really was, because there's just a lot more people at UBS versus Goldman, you know, during the early days, and then somehow they later on decided to change to become like more US firm-like. So productivity driven. So suddenly I'm like, how is suddenly all the people are gone and I have to do a lot more, you know? But nevertheless, the other two kids came in the early part of our UBS day. So I have four. And then I think when you have them, you just kind of deal with it, you know? And so I think I didn't think so much as in like, you know, can I cope or what? I think I was younger and they're cute, you know, so I just kept having it. And then I think the real world started to come, as Mandela said, which is primary school. But I had them all when they are like in kindergarten, so just didn't experience it. So in a way, I think the crux of it is about prioritization and organization. Because when you have so little time and you have to do everything, you just got to be very organized. And so my brother used to tease me, he's like, wow, you run your household like a boot camp. You know? And I look at them, I'm like, sorry, you have two kids, your wife doesn't work. Okay, so just don't say anything. but that's really it, you know, and prioritize. So I was just sharing with my panelists that I don't really bother kind of with the feeding or the bathing, you know. I really focus on their education and their well-being and health. So it's you just have to prioritize, right? Whereas I still have some mentees or in a professional industry where they're new moms, you know, they just have the first child. They're really late 20s or early 30s, and they're just really desperate to go home and bathe the baby. Now, I have nothing against that because it is a just different kind of connection, you know, but I tell them, but then there is distraction, right? Because you're always on this time. So I kind of tell them, well, you kind of have to, in a way, make a choice. I think as a woman, you sort of have to make a choice. You can have both, but you have to make priorities. You can still have the quality time with the children, but probably not quantity, right? So that, you know, those are the type of things that I would share. And at the end of the day, it is their choice. So some of them would maybe for a few years take a little bit of a stagnation, or they still have a job. But they maybe work out with the manager that they may not want to be too ambitious for a few years, but still stay connected in the work. And then when the kids grow older, then obviously they could kind of re-energize and re-engage.
I think when you have young kids, that's a challenge for a lot of women. And Stella, I know that you have a 12-year-old boy.
I do, yes.
Was that the key challenge in your career? What was the most difficult time? Because I know you've moved from company to company, countries, you've been in the UK, US, now in Hong Kong.
Yeah. Can I just say, I achieved in everything except for having children. I'm just down to one. I stuck at one, I stayed at one, I got back into my career. To your point, being in Hong Kong is excellent to get back into the workforce if you need to. But also for me, I have support. I have support from help. I think we're all sitting on this panel with support from help. And I get the opportunity to be able to balance it, as you say, make priorities. I'm fortunate, I've got the 12-year-old now, the boy, who the connection between males and females is interesting from very little all the way until very old. So to your point earlier, I've moved around a lot, and that is maybe because I'm an expatriate or I'm just from Hong Kong. I've moved from different countries. Hong Kong is the best place, I feel, to be able, as a woman, to get back into the workforce. Go on.
I'm actually surprised that you would say that, because that takes me right to my next point. Because I would feel that being in Asia, it would be a bit more difficult, maybe in some industries, for women to do business. How do you feel about that? Do you feel the real estate industry here in Asia could be different from the other places you've been?
Yes, absolutely. Everywhere in the world is different. Everywhere has positives and negatives. Hong Kong is moving forward, though. I mean, I work for a global firm, JLL. And, of course, there are initiatives around the world. It's bringing them all together. We've started something locally here for women. I've been involved with the Women's Foundation, with Women of Influence, with the British Chamber. I was in the event today. We're changing things. We need the men to come. Men. We definitely need you to be involved. So the video earlier, it needs to come from the top. And everybody needs to be genuine about it. So yes, I think that Hong Kong is a great place. There is this culture in Hong Kong, we all know it, we all love it, we love it and hate it at the same time. But I think it's got its positives.
Christina, I know that investment banking is pretty competitive, as well as real estate. How would you feel women do there?
It's very interesting. I still vividly remember whenever I talked to the younger professional women, I said that there are a few years that is probably the most frustrating. You enter, and it's actually 50-50 in terms of the female versus male kind of entry level in the investment bank. And then somehow you get to the middle, maybe after about 7 or 8 years, then suddenly there's just a lot more men around, because either the female decided to have a family and they make the choice that they want to stop for a few years or whatnot, then all of a sudden you're surrounded by it. But from my perspective, I always said that you just need to really bear through those few years of frustration. Then actually you're at a level where there's just not as much competition, let's put it that way, as a female. And actually when it comes to promotion time, big firms especially do focus in diversity, especially in the last 10 years. I think it's very obvious. So when you pass through those few frustrating years, so to speak, then you're at a place where you actually probably could get promoted faster and easier than the men who are still trying to poke on each other's back and back mouth it. They wouldn't do that to you, right? Because they know that to a certain extent you are in contention, right? So they're just trying to fight the other male counterpart. So that's actually what I saw in a way. During my corporate ladder rise. But there are years that you're frustrated, you're trying to balance things, and you go back home very stressed out. And so I think having a good, having a very understanding husband is actually, or partner, is very important, because they have to bear a lot of your stress too.
Well, you've been in the business for 3 decades in Hong Kong. Do you feel, as Christina said, that as you climb the corporate ladder, there's less competition from women?
I have to say, in my experience and observation, is very different, and definitely not the case in Swire Properties. maybe I have been lucky, as I said earlier. As you point out, I really didn't feel that being a woman has disadvantaged me or held me back. I was lucky to be appointed as the first woman GM in the company, and I'm now one of the three women in the senior management group of 11 today. And if I have to look at the statistic in Swire Properties, for the middle management, women percentage are talking about 46% versus industry of 43%. And for the very top senior management level, we are about 27% women, which was considered very good in Hong Kong, I have to say. So, if you look at our women in the company, we have the one heading like finance department, in the business development department, And recently, we actually have appointed a new woman to be the head of the projects department, which was labeled as the man's job in the past. And I was glad that she was here today joining us. So it's very different in my area. And I actually want to use this opportunity to ask all of you to think whether we need to think about women being discriminated or we have less opportunity in the industry. Is it help? Does it actually help us to find a solution for that? Because for my own experience, if I had felt I need to fight men to succeed or to develop my career, I wonder if I would have been successful.
No, I think I just want to remind as well that I think about as the right Swire actually is one of the best company in terms of promoting women. I know it because it's on the board of DWF, and our CEO Su Ming has endorsed a very good program, which is about the 30% club, which is about corporate signing up to basically have an incentive or just basically directive to try to get the board members to be at 30%. And Swire is actually one of the big supporters of that program. So I think, you know, there are organizations out there that are particularly good at that. Yeah.
Well, I know ladies where you can head. Swire properties, lots of PR today, but I guess not lots of companies are like that. Especially, let's say, even if it's not the company that's helping you sell, for example, you work in different parts of the world and also different companies. How about women being pigeonholed at certain roles? As Mabel said earlier, some jobs that are only thought for as men.
I think that is the case, most definitely, that we are pigeonholed. We're pigeonholed also that we're really good at it. So I run the residential team. It's an emotive business. We all know in here that we're really good at that. So, of course, I have 91% women in my team. So that's pretty excellent. I can see there's some other residential ladies out here as well. So do we get pigeonholed? I think there's a difference between pigeonholed and just really good at what we do. We have other departments in our company, and certainly at JLL. We're growing our female skills, our female talents, bringing women to the table. We get pigeonholed when we're really good, but I think if you're with the right firm and the right company, you can break out of that. You get the support from the women that are really good at what they do, and they'll help you get into the other parts of the business if that's where you want to go.
Abel, how do you move up the corporate ladder being a woman?
I guess the key thing is to have the right mix of course, technical and professional knowledge and skill to do the right business. But I guess it's more important to have the people management skill, which is very crucial to develop a strong team for success. And in that regard, I have to say, women or myself, tends to be better in developing and coaching people. I thought of that for a long time. Why was that? Why can we do a better sort of coaching and developing skill? I guess women tend to be able to give more open, fair, and sometimes tough feedback to the staff. And especially in the coaching section in the staff development discussion, they are very important. And the last, I think, is as women, somehow we don't have those competitive or aggressive genes as those men might have. So we tend to look at things, handle people in a more accommodating, nurturing, and a way that we can look at things in a wider perspective.
Christina, I know that for you, dealing with people and all of those skill sets that Mabel just mentioned has been more challenging than because you have to deal with your own family, because you're in a family-owned company. Tell us about your experience there.
Yeah, actually, because I came from a 16-year corporate background, And most of my bosses, except one, were all men. And they actually are all very, very good. And so they have been promoting me and very supportive and allowed me to develop a very clear perspective and appreciate my opinions. So gradually I become this fairly opinionated, outspoken, you know, senior management, which is totally fine in the corporate world during my experience. And then I was invited to join my brother's partnership by them. And then, of course, I'm used to doing the way I do, and I'm basically asked to lead the area that my whole career has been, which is more on the sales side, fundraising, which is basically my whole career. You know, I was in a managing sales team in the equities division in the region. So it was all my forte, right? So it was very easy for me to fit in. But then the difficult part is really about, as Sherry was saying, then I just act the way I always do in the corporate, but then it wasn't really very well taken at the beginning because they're not really used to being told you cannot do this or this is probably not the right way because they're used to kind of running things on their own. I think as a female, I think they're also drawn to a lot of similar situations where I think men and women are different. I think men, probably, hopefully the men here also may agree. There is the ego side, there is the face issue, which is a little bit less pronounced with women. Maybe when you're younger, there's a bit more of that. Like I would give an example, as in like, or I might have suggested an idea, which is definitely a correct and great idea. But then at that very moment when I say it, the guys just don't want to take it, or just pretend don't want to take it, and say something back. Okay, and then of course at the beginning you don't know that yet. You don't know how they do things yet. You get kind of angry. You're younger. You're just like, you know, I know I'm right. You know, and then so they walk away, and say something, and then you get angry. And then you realize that 2 weeks later they say exactly what I said to them. So in that sense, but it may not be like she suggested or whatever. But it didn't matter, right? Because at the end of the day, I achieved what I wanted to achieve because that's what I wanted the company to go for or the direction, and it came out, and it didn't matter, you know, who said it. Okay, so I think those are probably some elements where it's probably slightly different. And so I didn't want to stereotype, but it is to a certain extent something that I have experienced quite a lot. And so over time you learn to, as an EQ, you set emotional intelligence. I think as a female, because we have to be moms, you know, daughters, a lot of roles to play, you tend to be a little bit more sensitive to other side's feelings. And guys have their better things, which sometimes they're more gutsy, you know, because somehow they're just born that way, a little bit of that thinking. Women can be sometimes a little bit more conservative, although I think the new world education is training women to be quite different in that they could be kind of more.
Yeah, can I just say to that point? That's exactly what we're talking about, diversity. So men are good at this, women are good at that. Bring us together. You know, bring us together so we can work together. You get us around the table, we come up with amazing ideas. So this isn't about excluding men or men not being here. This is about men and women coming together. Our strengths, your strengths, their strengths. And that isn't just about males and females. That's about diversity when it comes to culture, when it comes to where you grew up. Everything, all those ideas and concepts coming together in one big round pot.
And so you were telling me earlier that there's a difference between doing business in Western cultures and doing it here in Hong Kong, that there's another layer. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, I think it's cultural. We're all in Hong Kong. We love it, as I said earlier. But there is a cultural level. Mabel, you work at a very British firm in Hong Kong. I'm in a US firm, a very international firm in Hong Kong. And I mean, your banks and even Gore Capital, we are here in Hong Kong. Face, we all know it exists. So you've got to tweak things. And again, that lends itself to all of us being around together, learning different things from each other, sharing, and putting them all together so that therefore we are presenting, I feel, across the board sort of, concepts, personalities, characters, everything like that.
Well, would you tell your 13-year-old daughter to be in the real estate business?
I guess it's not me telling her what to do. Nowadays, kids.
Would you be comfortable telling her?
I think I'm doing a good role model for her. From time to time, she can see that mom is trying to sort of do what we enjoy and what we do best. So I thought she will pick the same and just try her very best to continue.
Well, that's interesting for me. How many of us are in real estate in this room currently? That's not too bad on the old hands. How many of us want to go into real estate?
I was going to ask for, you've been a charter surveyor for 20 years. Is there, because we know that some of the women in this business haven't really had a formal degree, a formal education in this field, like Mabel, you just fell into it. Is there any skill sets that you need?
I guess it's the same I just mentioned, like it's all this mixture of professional and technical knowledge side. But in addition to that is the flexibility that you need to have in looking into the opportunities. And you can't be so rigid and say, I don't want to do this, I don't want to do that. Especially when we were young, we need to go, as I call it, wider rather than deeper, so that you know each area in the early days, and you won't miss the opportunities.
Stella, do you ever miss not having a business degree or something to real estate when you were younger?
Certainly hasn't stopped me getting where I am. So I would say no. When it comes to skills, there's a long list, but you have to be empathetic. You have to be genuine. You have to genuinely want to be in real estate. And if you genuinely want to be in it, it will happen.
Let's talk about best practice. What does it take to keep women in the field? What do you think, Christina?
If I look around my own company now, we actually just had a staff retreat celebrating our 10-year anniversary. So one of the games that we played was some trivial question. One of them is about the female and male representation. We actually have 49% female. Although at the senior manager level, out of four partners, just me. But then the senior, but still, one layer down, there's still quite a lot of women, I would say, on actually the acquisition team. So I think earlier with the question touching on certain roles, whether it's pigeonholed, if I look at my own company, it's very interesting because, and I didn't even see it, but deal team have more women, actually, which is the acquisition team. My team, which is on the capital market side, I have more male. Actually, that was not intentional. It was just somehow it fits into when we were hiring, it was just kind of how it fits through. So I think, in terms of, if I look at my company, obviously it attracted a lot of females and it progressed along. I think one of the key things is we do offer quite a lot of balance of life. In a way, we are no longer in this like FaceTime kind of, like FaceTime, meaning that how many hours I see you sitting in your chair. Because our work, whether it's deal team or marketing team, we're actually constantly on the road. So if sometimes this is my office, sometimes I go to the deal team floor, it's kind of empty. But it's understandable because they should be out there getting deals, and if you're fundraising, you also should be out there having meetings and getting the money. So it's driven by productivity. And I think that work environment actually also suits a lot of working moms, because we don't need them physically to be around. They need to see their kids, they need to bring them to school, they can. And if they need to go on holiday, they can, but they're always reachable. Right? So I think the modern world is because of all the technology advancement, it gets you very busy because you never stop. But on the other hand, physically, you're not as founded. I don't know whether that's